The New York City lawyer caught on camera berating people for speaking Spanish and threatening to call immigration, trying to keep a low profile tonight, dodging reporters. I want to bring in now Tim Wise. Tim is an anti-racism writer and activist who's the author of Dear White America. CNN political commentators Tara Setmeyer and Steve Cortez are here as well. Good evening. So Tim, CNN is aware of at least three separate incidents this attorney has been involved in. And one of the things that's ironic is that on his website, he offers services in multiple languages, including Spanish. When you saw this story, when I saw this story, I wanted to talk to you and I wanted to get your thoughts. What do you think?
Well, look, if the problem were just this one guy, then it wouldn't be worth having this conversation. But the reality is, we've got video after video and incident after incident just in the last couple of weeks. How many white folks are calling police on black people for absolutely no reason? We've got videos of people melting down on YouTube, yelling at baristas at Starbucks about bad service and being discriminated against because they're white men and they can't catch a break. We've got story after story of young children. We're talking middle school age kids being taunted with chants of build the wall, build the wall. And let me tell you this story. This is heartbreaking. A friend of mine who I've known for 35 years, his family lives in New York. His kid, middle school kid, was on a trip in Washington at the Smithsonian about a week ago. Very diverse group of middle school kids. They come across another group of kids, white kids, bunch of them with, you know, Make America Great Again t-shirts and hats. And one of the white kids in that t-shirt looks at his shirt, points at it, says, "This is made of cotton. Thank you for picking it." Says that to one of the black kids. None of the teachers, none of the chaperones do anything to this kid, and it nearly touches off a fracas. They had to get the kids from the diverse school out of there before anything went wrong. This is the kind of stuff that is happening. For every incident on tape, there are dozens of incidents that are not being caught on tape, and this is filtering down to young children. There's clearly something wrong culturally in this country that we're not addressing.
Tara, to you now. I mean, and listen, Tara, you know, you've lived in the New York City metropolitan area. We've hung out here together. We know what New York City is like, very diverse. When you see a young, attractive, successful businessman screaming at people in Manhattan because they're speaking Spanish, what did you think?
Yeah, you know, this guy obviously is an equal opportunity xenophobe. You know, he's looking at this spectacle like this. It's disturbing, of course. You know, like, what are you doing in New York City? I grew up in New Jersey. I mean, it's a melting pot in the Northeast like that. So to see these kinds of outbursts was like, what is happening? But I will tell you that, you know, after watching more and more videos of this guy, he's obviously got a problem. There's something wrong with him. He's clearly a racist. He's an equal opportunity xenophobe, like I said. One time it was about Latinos. Another time it was someone that was speaking in a Slavic language. Another time it was just an effing foreigner he called someone. So, you know, this guy is the epitome of something that's been unearthed, I think, since in the era of Trump. And as someone who is biracial, who has lived in New York and New Jersey, who's lived in Washington, D.C., and who's been all over the country, all over the world, actually, I have never seen the kinds of ugliness that I've seen from people who you wouldn't expect, right, since Trump came into office. Yeah. And in the Republican Party, I have to say, the party that I have been a part of and as a conservative for most of my adult life, to sit back and make excuses for it, or to stay silent and just kind of act as though this is not happening, is very disconcerting for me. And they should be ashamed of themselves for not acknowledging that Donald Trump has created an environment to divide people and make it okay because of the way he behaves and the things that he has said.
I need to get Steve in. Steve, what do you say?
Look, this guy's an ass. Of one jerk to Donald Trump, to me, is an absurd leap of logic. This guy's a jerk. I don't see the political bent here. I just don't.
Okay, hang on, Tara. Hold on, Tara. Tara, hold on. Please.
Every time
we have a video and we put it on,
right,
someone who supports Trump says, this is one person.
Right.
And to ascribe that to one person is just outrageous. Then we put on another one, and you say the same thing. Then we put on another one, and you say the exact same thing. And another one, and another one, and another one. So how long does that excuse hold water that it's just one person?
Don,
every single person here has just said it's more than one person. It's more than one person.
I will answer that, all right? As a minority, all right, as a son of an immigrant who had a dad who, by the way, spoke with a heavy accent, embarrassed me as a kid. I'm ashamed it embarrassed me, but that's just
the way
it is.
We got three minorities on this panel. Go on. We get it. Go on. Make your point, please.
All right. But no, but it's important, Don, okay? That's what I'm saying. I've lived this. I get it. Yes, it is important.
You can be a minority and still be a bigot.
No. Hold on.
And you can be a minority and still not be aware of bigotry.
Don,
you
can still be a minority. I'm still talking.
I'm still talking as well.
I'm still talking, Don.
You can be a minority and still make excuses for bigots and racists and homophobes and xenophobes and anti-Semites.
I get the idea of being other is what I'm saying. I get the idea of being out of the norm, right, of speaking with an accent or speaking a different language. I get it totally. I get it in a visceral sense. I also believe this about America, thank goodness. This country, which was once fundamentally racist.
Can we stick to the point?
Right?
Steve, stick to the point. Let's
I'm
talk
on
about
point.
This issue.
Can you let me, can you make,
I have,
me make my point?
I've got,
this country
I've
that
got
was
a minute. Can you just stick to the point?
Fundamentally racist. You're not even letting me get to my point. This
it's
country
taking you too
that
long.
Was once
come on, move it along.
Fundamentally racist. All right, I'll be quick. This country that was once fundamentally racist, that believed that black people could be owned, elected twice a black man named Barack Hussein Obama.
Don,
tell me we're fundamentally racist, and we elected
Donald Trump
and we elected him twice.
Hold on. He had a lot of time. Okay. He had a lot of time,
go
and
ahead,
he took up a lot of air.
Yeah.
If Barack Obama winning twice means that racism is fundamentally eradicated, then I guess Steve would argue that there's no real sexism in Pakistan because a woman, Benazir Bhutto, was elected there twice. That's an ignorant seventh grade level argument that has just been made on national television. Surely we can do better than that.
But we also can just use the examples of Donald Trump himself, the things that he has said, from, you know, the Judge Curiel stuff, that he couldn't be a good judge because he was a Mexican. You know, the comments that he has made, the bigoted comments over and over again, have given people like this jerk off license to be able to think it's okay to behave this way. Look at how many people running for Congress have said things that are inappropriate as Republicans. Look what Blankenship did in West Virginia. Thank God he lost. You know, talking about Chinamen in Mitch McConnell's family, and you got this guy down in Georgia running around in a deportation bus, for goodness sakes.
Right.
This kind of stuff, you would never have seen this under George W. Bush.
Steve,
point is that these people are feeling emboldened to do it because the president of the United States says there's good people on both sides in Charlottesville.
Okay, let him respond.
I mean,
let him respond.
Here's the thing, okay? This Schlossberg, again, I don't know how many ways I can say it. He's apparently a racist. He's an ass. He should be paid no attention to. But here's the thing,
Trump
too. $500. What's going on now is the so what? What does that mean?
Why?
That's the law of large numbers.
People feel it's okay to behave this way at Trump
here's
rallies.
The thing.
Why is it okay?
Racism
this guy
has
did
become
this with a MAGA head on
let
a Trump
it,
rally.
Let it
racism.
Yeah.
Explain that.
Racism has become. It has become not the scarlet A, but the scarlet R. It's become the scarlet letter of the left. When they don't want to talk policy, when you all don't want to talk about what we are doing in the Trump movement, for minorities, by the way, for their prosperity and security, what you do is you call us racist, and it's a way of maligning us, it's a way of marginalizing us, and taking us
look,
out of the
Steve,
debate.
Who's
once you put that
you,
on our
right?
chest, personalizing
no longer
Donald
be
Trump,
hold on, hold on,
part
hold on.
Of the
hold on, hold on
Donald
hang on,
Trump.
Hang on, Tim. Steve, why are you personalizing this? No one called you a racist.
No one.
Yeah. And no one. And no
I have
one,
been called a racist.
No
so,
right, so you're, so
ever
you're
since,
saying.
Maybe not on this show, but I've been called a racist
the left,
constantly.
You're saying
when
someone from the left told this guy to go into a restaurant and call out people for
right.
not speaking
right.
English?
No.
Right.
Guy, or the
right.
guy, the
no,
white
no,
guy at the
that's
Trump
not what
rally
I said at all,
that punched
Don.
The black guy.
What I'm saying is.
Or Trump
what
saying
I'm saying
that there's
is
good
I,
people on both
because,
sides, making excuses
because
for David Duke.
I am a supporter of Trump. I have been affixed to this jerk, even though I have nothing to do with him.
But
and that's been done
thing.
Continually
when
since the day I came out
when children
for Donald
are walking
Trump.
Around
Steve, he's wearing a Make
children,
America Great hat again.
When children are
ahead.
Walking around in Trump look, gear talking to black right. children about picking
look,
cotton.
The law
if,
of,
let, no, let me finish. I didn't interrupt law, you, really, except for the $500 comment. Let me finish. If anyone had been walking around in Obama shirts and hats in 2008 attacking white people verbally or making $500 contributions to Barack Obama's campaign, you know full well that you would have made an issue of it. You would have asked Barack Obama to condemn those
no,
people, and
no,
you
I
would
wouldn't.
Certainly
and
not ask.
No, I wouldn't.
Yes, you,
no,
yes,
I wouldn't.
You would.
Look, the law of large numbers, okay, when you have tens of millions of people, you're going to have crazies on both sides. This guy's a crazy. There are crazies on the left. That is the law of large numbers.
So you don't think that it comes from the top when President Trump makes the comments that he makes, that doesn't embolden these crazies to come out? I mean, I can remember when Bill Buckley, who was a conservative hero of mine, cast out the John Birch Society because of how inappropriate and the fanatical positions that they were taking. He took a stand because it was the right thing to do. Why can't you just take a stand and condemn the kinds of things that Donald Trump has said that is emboldening these kinds of people and embolden these nutcases and fanatics and racists and bigots
to run for
office and put an R next to their name?
If we're going to follow this logic, did the shooter of Congressman Scalise, all right, is that Bernie Sanders' fault because he happened to be an ardent supporter of Bernie Sanders? I think that's ludicrous logic. But by your logic,
no, it's not.
Did Bernie Sanders?
By your logic,
Bernie Sanders hold on.
Every bit as complicit.
Okay, here's the difference. Bernie Sanders and his supporters condemned it.
Immediately.
And they said,
immediately. I'm condemning it right here on national television.
No, you're making
excuses.
I'm
saying this guy's a loon.
You're making
excuses. Why won't you condemn the things Trump has said?
I'm saying this guy's a loon. I am totally,
condemning
him. He does not represent the president, and he doesn't represent our movement. He is
but when the president
element.
When the president said the
Trump
last president, when this president said the last president wasn't even born in this country, and he believed that publicly for 4 years, you didn't condemn that. That was blatant dog whistling.
Yes, I did. As a matter of fact, actually, you don't know me because I did. Yes, I did.
Do you think
I condemned it many times on air, and I said that was a foolish. That was a foolish.
No, it wasn't foolish.
That
it was
he
racist.
Down, and I
it
wish
was
he had.
Racist.
All right,
and to
it was
say
foolish.
It makes a
and so, no, but you just
racist.
Said I didn't condemn
okay.
it, and
Steve,
I did, and
Steve.
I'm on the record.
Okay, Steve,
it again
you condemned
again.
It. You condemned it, and you condemned the guy for doing. You saying he this doesn't represent the Trump movement. Okay, fine, believe that. Do you think that when President Trump or Donald Trump said that the former president wasn't born in this country and kept it going and was the biggest promoter of that, do you think that was racist?
I don't think it was racist, but I think it was a big mistake. And again, I said that again and again.
Not just today. About Judge
I said it at the time.
Being not able to do his job
at the
as a judge because he was a Mexican.
I said that again and again. But
was that
the idea that
has this president ever done anything that you think is racist?
Or said anything?
Or said anything?
Gosh, no. Absolutely not.
Gosh,
he's
no.
not a racist.
Not
this
no,
man,
no.
and
gosh,
I know him.
No.
Okay?
Bigoted.
This
right.
man once. No, and again, here you go with the scarlet
okay.
letter. Here you go
stand
again.
By, stand by. Play
Let's
it. Play it. Play it. Play it.
They're bringing drugs. They're bringing crime. They're rapists. And some, I assume, are good people.
Look at my African-American over here. Look at him. Are you the greatest?
I would like to have him show his birth certificate. If he can't, and if he wasn't born in this country, which is a real possibility, I'm not saying it happened, I'm saying it's a real possibility.
His wife, if you look at his wife, she was standing there, she had nothing to say, she probably, maybe she wasn't allowed to have anything to say, you tell me.
You had some very bad people in that group, but you also had people that were very fine people on both sides.
Are you racist?
I am the least racist person that you have ever met.
You want to change your mind, Steve, or you still stick with it, what you said?
No, I am not changing my mind. And by the way, as I just said, the birth certificate controversy I thought was absurd. I don't know why he went down that road.
It's not absurd.
Mistake.
The word is racist.
No, it's not racist. Stop it.
Or maybe
he
should
stop.
List
no,
all the times Trump was
by
sued
the way,
for being racist.
He
How about that?
During the campaign, reversed himself and said the president was clearly born in the United States. He corrected himself, okay?
But he continually
he
said
on the
that
record,
there were people investigating, finding
himself.
Amazing, incredible things, which was a blatant lie. He hadn't hired anybody to find anything. Nobody was finding anything. There was nothing to find. He was pushing buttons of racial resentment, trying to get white
Here's
folks to believe
Look.
That the president of the United States was not an American citizen. And all throughout 2009 and 2010, at those Tea Party rallies, you had folks out there with posters, with pictures of the president with a bone through his nose, dressed like an African witch doctor saying, go back to Kenya. That is racism. And if you can't call it that, then it is because you do not understand the meaning of the word in spite of your ethnicity and background, which apparently you think gives you some type of gravitas to have this conversation. But the word is the word.
No,
it means
no,
what it means.
That,
and this president is guilty
all.
Of it time
I also
and time
think, once again.
Again,
and I don't know how
and
many
Donald
times
Trump,
I've said this, the law of large numbers.
Multiple times
there are crazies on both sides. There are crazies on your side. There are crazies on the right. That doesn't mean that the leader, doesn't mean Bernie Sanders is responsible for the shooter.
Well, how often do you see how often do you see the other side doing this, Steve?
Well, quite a bit. I mean, like I just said, the violence in the ballpark against Republicans.
Okay, that's one incident which was awful.
Roll the tape.
People who are ugly,
where are yours? Yeah.
People who are ugly or violent on either side should be dismissed. Mm-hmm. Okay? They should be. They should be relegated to the sidelines. They don't matter in our country.
Why would you dismiss an example of something that's in your face time and time and time again? And by the way, I take umbrage to you saying that this guy or you, whoever made the point that this guy is crazy, there's clearly something wrong with him. I don't know that. I encounter people like him all the time. These are everyday racists. These are everyday bigots. These are people that you encounter all the time in life. And every time it happens, you just can't say, oh my gosh, this person is crazy, and conflating them with people who have something wrong with him. They have something wrong with them. What's wrong with them is that they're racists and that it happens more than you think. And this is an example to people like you and to others who don't believe it happens.
Or that they've been emboldened to behave this way.
How could we have elected Barack Obama? I mean, I really mean
it's
that.
It's two separate things. I mean, you can still have people. You can still have people that elected Barack Obama, and there's also still a percentage of this country that are still bigoted and racist and think it's okay to behave like this because the president of the United States does. He sets
this
an example.
This idea that voting for Barack Obama, I already explained, you know, the Benazir Bhutto example, which I guess your earpiece
wasn't working. I don't care about your Pakistan.
I'm not really sure.
That has nothing to do with the United States. Irrelevant.
But do you not know how metaphor and analogies work? Analogies work because I compare one thing to another.
Actually.
No, you don't. Because if you did, you would understand that having one person from a marginalized group become the leader of a country says nothing about how other people from that group are experiencing that country. That is an analogy. It is direct. You do not understand it. Saying that voting for Barack Obama means that you can't be racist is like a guy who's heterosexual saying that because he dates or sleeps with or is married to a woman, he can't be a sexist. There's another analogy that completely destroys whatever point you are trying to make.
He's just deflecting because he won't acknowledge that Donald Trump makes bigoted statements. He's done it over and over. His own history
has demonstrated that.
What you're doing, I'm going to finish. Donald Trump was sued for racial discrimination in the 90s by black dealers in Atlantic City. He has made comments. It's well known that he's made comments that were off the cuff and inappropriate about blacks. And he didn't dispute an account in a book that was written about him where he said he would never have a black count his money. I mean, it's on and on. The way that he approaches these things, the way his own behavior, he didn't condemn the people, white people that knocked out black people at his rallies. There's things that he's said and done that you will not acknowledge. And this breeds this kind of culture now that we see with people that feel emboldened to behave like this other guy
Answer, Steve, let me add, I'm glad you said MAGA hat. So then why are people who are wearing MAGA hats and MAGA shirts and screaming MAGA and making... Why does it seem like it's always them if it's not an issue that has to do with Donald Trump?
It's certainly not always them. There's a lot of violence from Antifa. There's a lot of violence from many sides here, and there shouldn't be, by the way.
That's true,
political violence, racism, bigotry is awful from any side. I'll tell you this, too, by the way. If Donald Trump is a racist, which he clearly isn't, I know him, he's not. But if he is, he's remarkably bad at it. Because all he has done is make life better since he was elected for minorities, for African Americans, and for Hispanics.
Okay.
Economically, their prosperity, their security are only increasing under the policies of Donald Trump. So
which means
he's a remarkably bad
racist. The fact that people of color don't agree with that by and large means that they are delusional. I guess the fact that black folks, by and large, don't see it that way, and brown folk, by and large, don't see it that way, and they don't vote that way, means that you and Donald Trump know black and brown folks' truth better than they actually know their own truth, which is a fascinating example of prejudice as well.
It means that we need to... It means that we need to win them over, and we are starting
people
to do
know
that.
Their own
you think that calling
way.
African,
people
you think that calling
colors,
countries,
that they belong
countries,
in the Republican
why can't
Party,
they have more,
they
like Norway is winning people of color
Donald
over?
Trump. That's yeah. what it means.
So
it means
that there the are, Party so you didn't, you didn't live through the Obama administration when Obama brought the black, really brought the, that's all from Donald
the
Trump.
The chasm.
Well, we could have a different conversation
let's
about
talk facts, Don. Let's talk facts. The chasm between white household wealth and minority household wealth widened under the Obama years, and that is
and that has
fact.
Not actually
that's
declined.
That's
most that
is
not actually declined
because
the wealth gap has not
yes,
declined.
Because
one
most
bit.
Blacks
no, it has
and
not.
Hispanics yeah. are
that
among the
policy versus
Americans.
Attitude are different.
And the
wealth
slow
gap
growth
has not declined
of
at
the
all.
Obama years was wonderful for people who owned a lot of assets, which generally, unfortunately, does not include blacks and Hispanics. I want it to, and I think that will happen. I want blacks and Hispanics to be wealthy and own assets. But for the most part, we're wage earners,
yeah.
and wage earners had a terrible slog under the slow growth of the Obama
so
years.
So, Steve, you have no concern about you have no concern about the what seems like a spike or, in these racist incidents since this president came to fore?
And anti-Semitism.
No, well, mm-hmm. Those are two different anti-Semitism. Are you kidding?
Yes.
Donald Trump has been a better friend to Israel than any president has been probably
but his
since President Clinton.
Why is it?
Why is
it?
Why is
Israel?
Why is it that people
are not?
So hold on, one at a time.
Why is it? Why is Israel the only Jew? As the only
not
Jew
a friend,
on the panel.
Not
hold
a friend,
on.
The only Jew
I mean, are
Tim,
you kidding
let me?
Let me speak now.
Let,
as the only
Tim
Jew
speak.
On the panel, let me just say, the idea that anti-Semitism can be reduced to your view on Israel is offensive to me as a Jewish person. That's not what it means to stand up against anti-Semitism. What it means to stand up against it is when Nazis march in an American city and a college town, you do not coddle
yeah,
them and say that there were fine people on that side. It used to be we understood there was a difference between Nazis and people who fought Nazis. My grandfather fought Nazis, and we praised them and called them the greatest generation. Now we have a president who makes excuses for them, and he is your friend. Deal with him. Come get your people, please.
All right. I got to go. Thank you. Fascinating conversation. Frustrating one, but we need to have it. We need to have it. When we come back, the Washington Post reporting tonight that the president and his allies are waging a campaign to expose a top secret FBI source. More on that in a moment. Our breaking news, President Trump and his allies reportedly waging a campaign to undercut the Russia investigation by exposing a top secret FBI source. That is according to the Washington Post. Let's bring in now CNN national security analyst Julia Kayyem, CNN legal analyst Michael Zeldin, who was Robert Mueller's special assistant at the Justice Department. Whew, so let's talk some policy now, shall we? Good evening to both of you. Michael, you know, we've got this breaking news tonight about the Washington Post and President Rudy Giuliani claiming that there was a spy in the campaign and that they want this alleged FBI source exposed. What do you think of this?
Well, I think it's terrible from a law enforcement perspective, and Giuliani should be embarrassed having said this, given that he was both the mayor of New York in charge of police and also the United States Attorney for the Southern District of New York. There is an FBI informant, a live U.S. citizen, who apparently is providing and has provided the FBI information about ongoing investigations, including conversations perhaps with Carter Page and George Papadopoulos. That's a far cry from implanting an informant within the Trump organization, as Giuliani and others have alleged. And to out a source of vital intelligence for the FBI in ongoing investigations, to me, is just an unacceptable course of conduct. And I think that the Congress, who is Meadows and Nunez and others who are calling for this, really should be ashamed of themselves.
Mm-hmm. Julia, if this confidential source is revealed, I mean, couldn't that jeopardize other operations? That's what the concern is.
Oh, absolutely. And the Washington Post story does state explicitly that the FBI is working diligently to not only protect the identity of this source, but obviously protect any information that this source may have revealed or helped in other investigations. Remember, we're not just talking about the Mueller investigation. There are any number of other investigations going on related to Russians, related to Manafort's son-in-law. I mean, there's a whole bunch of stuff going on. And so the exposure of that person's name will compromise ongoing criminal investigations. So just two things here. If you don't think that this is obstruction of justice, I don't know how you would define it. There is a there is an informant, right? It's not a spy. Informants are used in all sorts of criminal cases. That the President of the United States and his proxies are directing to be exposed to undermine not just the Mueller case, but other cases. The second is, and I'm not speaking, you know, I'm very careful with hyperbole, but, you know, when I first read this story, my thought was, you know, they're going to get someone killed, you know? I mean, in the sense that you don't play with this stuff. We have no idea
who
this person is. Yeah, I mean, we have no idea who this person is. We have no idea of what the Russians will do. We know there's lots of dead Russians in Russia and in Britain. But, you know, so this idea that this is all just sort of fun and games and a witch hunt on Twitter and we get to call it whatever I want, it's like, this is real. And I think, you know, to lay blame everywhere, I mean, obviously it's with Donald Trump and his paranoia and his, you know, and the fact that he has no legal defense left, right? I mean, in other words, his only legal defense is this now. But also, of course, on Devin Nunes and Paul Ryan, who could have really legitimately gotten rid of Devin Nunes as the head of the House Intelligence Committee and has failed to do so for over a year. That will be Paul Ryan's legacy in my mind.
You know that was not going to happen. It's sad, though, but...
Right. And you have to juxtapose this.
You're right about the legacy.
Don, I think one thing to add to what Juliet said is that you have to juxtapose this against the brouhaha that was made about unmasking and other things of that sort, which suited them fine to make a big to-do about the possibility that somebody may have unmasked somebody, a Democrat may have unmasked somebody.
And it winds up being nothing.
Well, it wound up being nothing, but they wanted you know, prosecutions and the like. And here, when the director of the FBI says this would compromise ongoing investigations, and there doesn't seem to be a care in the world, it's just not acceptable.
Well, of course, it's hypocrisy, and for anyone to say otherwise, they're just lying to themselves, or they don't really want to face reality when it comes to what's happening here. Look, there's more news tonight. I want to talk about Paul Manafort. His former son-in-law is pleading guilty to a real estate Ponzi scheme and will now cooperate with other investigations. How significant is that, Juliet?
So it's hard to tell right now. So this is happening in a California court. Just back to my previous point, there are so many tentacles to what's going on right now and some real estate dealings. But he has, at least by reporting, sort of agreed that he would discuss discuss what he knew about Manafort's dealings with Russia and, of course, Manafort and whether there was any collusion with the Trump campaign. So right now, the fact that he's willing to plea is just so... I think it's just revealing the extent to which Mueller is successfully and methodically getting people closer and closer to the Oval Office to turn, right, for whatever reason. But the content of what he knows, I think we should be careful. We just simply don't know how much he knew and whether the main goal of having the son-in-law turn is simply to get Manafort to eventually turn.
All right. Thank you, both of you. That's got to be the last word. When we come back, President Trump's Fox News feedback loop. The extraordinary claims the president makes, all because of what he has seen on Fox News.
You haven't seen the sun in like forever.
So here's our breaking news tonight. President Trump and his allies waging a campaign to discredit the Russia investigation by trying to expose a top secret FBI source and using conservative media to do it. Let's bring in CNN political commentator Margaret Hoover, CNN political analyst Brian Karam, and Olivia Nuzzi, Washington correspondent for New York Magazine. Good evening, all of you. Thank you for coming on. Olivia,
good evening,
I have to start
Don.
With you. And I need to talk about this new story in the Washington Post that I just read a little bit of about the Trump allies, how they're trying to expose this top secret FBI source. The informant, they are claiming, was a spy in the campaign. And this is what Josh Dossie writes for the Washington Post. The extraordinary push begun by a cadre of Trump boosters on Capitol Hill now has champions across the GOP and throughout the conservative media. And as of Thursday, the first anniversary of Robert S. Mueller III's appointment as special counsel bears the imprimatur of the president. So, Olivia, you've reported extensively on the president's relationship with Fox News and conservative media. What's your reaction to this story?
Well, look, the president and Fox News have been in sync in their opposition to the entire intelligence community. And I think that this story exposes kind of the extent to which they are opposed to the intelligence community. A lot of what you see on Fox News echoes what we see on the president's Twitter account, obviously. Today, he's talking again about the witch hunt. And when you watch something like Sean Hannity, you see them talking about how there is the quote-unquote deep state, a term that really was a fringe term from people like Alex Jones not too long ago that has kind of trickled into the mainstream. And what they're talking about is the fact that they believe that the media, that the left in American politics, and that the intelligence community is really in cahoots against the president and this administration. And I think that they do everything in their power to undermine the investigation by claiming that there is a big conspiracy at play.
Yeah. Margaret Hoover, here's what the president tweeted today. He said, wow, word seems to be coming out that the Obama FBI spied on the Trump campaign with an embedded informant. Andrew McCarthy says there's probably no doubt that they had at least one confidential informant in the campaign. If so, this is bigger than Watergate. He was referring to this interview. Here it is on Fox and Friends.
There's probably no doubt that they had at least one confidential informant in the campaign.
So the president making another extraordinary claim because of something he saw on Fox News is concerning for you.
Yeah, and by the way, Andrew McCarthy is a respected lawyer. I mean, he litigated the case against the blind sheikh, which was the individual who perpetrated the bombing of the 1993 World Trade Center. Sheikh. So he's respected. So I don't totally understand that. But what I do know is that somebody did have an informant in the Trump campaign, and that was Russian intelligence in the form of Papadopoulos, who yes. is proven to be an FBI informant, or I'm sorry, rather a Russian informant. And then two of Trump's top campaign operatives, the person who became his national security advisor and the person who was his chairman, also have ties and were under investigation and have been indicted because of their illegal dealings related to Russia and how they handled their positions on the campaign. What this effort, Republican senators across the table and Republican members of Congress across the table have said, while there are Republicans who say this is politically driven, there are also impartial Republicans who are looking at the facts and have seen the briefing material and say, this is not a politically motivated investigation. Certainly there are people who spin things up on the right. Not entirely. Okay. There are. I mean, I don't know. I know that you didn't like Marco Rubio. Donald Trump was your guy. But there are people who don't have political motivations for looking and have the ability to look at the facts and say that that there is a real reason to investigate that a foreign government was trying to influence our elections. And as American citizens, all of us need to understand what's at the bottom of that. And that is not politically driven.
So, Brian, let's talk about the White House, how they're putting this out and responding. The White House said today that if the FBI had an informant within the Trump campaign, it should be investigated. Shouldn't the White House substantiate claims that they hear on Fox News before they put it out there?
Well, why would they bother doing that? They haven't done it in a year and a half that they've been there. I think at the bottom line, you know, Don, the sad part is 20 years from now, you're going to have to explain to our children and children yet unborn, our grandparents and the parents are going to have to say, where did you fall in the year 2018 when the President of the United States tried to dismantle the Constitution? And you're going to have to answer that because we know where Donald Trump and his administration
New York City lawyer
and that is,
on camera
they will protect,
people for speaking
they will
Spanish
make any claim that serves the president. They will make any claim that will serve him personally. They are not backing up any of these claims with facts. They haven't, they won't, and they can't. And the problem with that is it dismantles everything that we put together in 200 plus years as a republic. And they have no respect for it. And that becomes increasingly apparent every day when you take a look at how they have gotten into a bunker mentality, mm-hmm. how they've closed themselves off from the press, they've canceled press briefings, they've canceled joint press conferences, and the president, as I said before, has seen the open press in a solo news conference once.
You're talking about this administration, not Republicans at
yes.
large.
Yeah. No, I'm talking about Donald Trump.
But John, the problem is not so much that they're canceling the press briefings. I think as it is that when they do hold these press briefings, they're not telling us the truth, and they are frequently lying to us.
Well, they've never done that. They've never told us the truth. I mean, in a year and a half that I've been there, I've gotten one factual answer, one out of hundreds of questions, and that was, is he going to have a physical? And then they came out and told us, yeah. Blarney, they trotted a doctor out and said he was the healthiest out of all the presidents ever.
And
this guy was the healthiest.
For Department of VA.
Yeah.
But
yes.
here's the point. Look, I take your point that there doesn't seem to be a huge amount of respect for the Constitution or our institutions.
Or facts.
Point taken. But you run the risk of hyperbole by saying they're dismantling the Constitution because we have
no,
to have
that's not hyperbole. When
no, no,
you
we
sit
have to
there,
have faith that citizens
no, no, no.
that our institutions
when you
are going to withstand
sit there
a single
you
individual in the presidency
Constitution,
or in the executive
and you throw
branch.
People
and by the way,
under the bus
no,
for
me.
No constitutional
way,
reason at all. When you disrespect the DOJ, when you respect the DOD, disrespect the DOD, and you come out and you say that they are running, that they
I've
have informants.
Right,
if you've got informants hidden everywhere, you disrespect the DOJ and every bit of work that the Justice Department has ever done. That dismantles
to
the Constitution.
To be continued. Thank you. We'll be right back. The former son-in-law of one of Trump's campaign managers has reached a plea agreement with United States attorneys. Joining me now, a member of the House Intel Committee, Democratic Congressman Eric Swalwell. We're talking about Paul Manafort's former son-in-law here. He is being investigated for a real estate Ponzi scheme. What's your reaction to this report?
Good evening, Donna. It shows that, I think the FBI is looking at and conducting an MRI of anyone associated with Donald Trump, his team, and who may have information about what members of Donald Trump's team were doing with regard to the Russians. And so this is encouraging to me because we had an opportunity to do this on the House Intelligence Committee and failed to do so. We didn't use the subpoena power that we had. We didn't compel witnesses to come in. And so I think the country wants to see Bob Mueller run this thing to the ground and make sure that we check all of the personal, political, and financial contacts that Donald Trump and his team had with the Russians.
All right, moving on now. The president was up early this morning slamming the Russian investigation on the one-year anniversary of Mueller's appointment, calling it disgusting, illegal, unwarranted. But the polls show that these attacks may be working with the American people, Congressman. Mueller's approval is down slightly, and slightly more Americans believe the things the president is saying about the investigation. Is time on the president's side here when it comes to the court of public opinion, at least?
Well, Don, we all would like to see special counsel bring forward to the American people what he has found. However, it is ludicrous for the president to say and take advantage of all of the Russian contacts that he had during the campaign and then complain that it's taking too long to count the Russians. When you lie to investigators, it takes longer to find out what the truth is. And we've already had guilty pleas for false statements to the FBI, whether it was from General Flynn or George Papadopoulos or others in the Trump orbit.
The Senate Intelligence Committee released their findings on the Russia investigation. They agree with the Intelligence Committee's assessment that Russia interfered in the 2016 election to help President Trump or candidate Trump then. Do you and other Democrats on the House Intel feel vindicated by that?
Well, we feel that the American people now have consensus. Three beats one. House Intelligence Democrats and Senate Intelligence Democrats and Republicans outnumber the isolated House Intelligence Republicans, who are the only ones who are saying that there was no preference by Putin for Donald Trump. So the best thing we can do, Don, is to show unity, use that as an antidote against future interference, because the Russians aren't leaving. We had a hearing today on the Intelligence Committee talking about China, and experts told us that China also has capabilities to interfere in our elections.
I want to talk about the transcripts from the Senate Intel's interview with Don Jr. More questions came up about that mystery phone call that he made during the lead up to the June 2016 Trump Tower meeting. And after it was over, a blocked number. He made a call to a blocked number. He said he doesn't remember who the call was from, but many suspect it might be his father, that it was his father who has been known to use a blocked number. What do you think?
Well, Don, at first, whenever a Trump family member says, I don't recall, that's typically code for yes, but you're getting too close. Russia calls Donald Trump Jr. And then a few minutes later, he calls a blocked number, and then he calls back to his Russian contacts. We know that Donald Trump, his father, used a blocked number. And so it was very critical as to whether he told his father. But proximity matters here. We know that candidate Trump was very close to the Russian family that requested the meeting. Candidate Trump was just one floor above where the meeting took place, and candidate Trump was very close throughout the campaign with his son, Donald Trump Jr., who took the meeting. It's so unlikely. Either he knew and they've all lied about it, or the family knew not to tell their father that this meeting took place.
Mm-hmm. President Trump did speak about Chinese electronics company ZTE. Watch, here's what he said.
ZTE was a company that I spoke to with President Xi. He asked me if I take a look at that because it was very harmful to them in terms of their jobs. I put very strong clamps on ZTE. They did very bad things to our country.
Why do you think the president is so concerned about ZTE?
Boy, Don, it sure looks like it's the money. He promised so many American workers that he would put them first in everything that he would do in the Oval Office. And here he's putting a Chinese company and its workers ahead of the American worker. The Chinese made a $500 million loan to a Trump-backed property at the same time that he's saying this. I think he should disavow that loan, show the American people that he's not going to have these financial dealings with China at the same time that he's trying to strike trade policy with them.
Congressman Swalwell, thank you, sir.
Yeah, my pleasure, Don.
When we come back, will Meghan Markle change the royal family? She's faced racism ever since she became engaged to Prince Harry, but will the royal wedding change the conversation?
With help from Senators McConnell and Grassley, President Trump has put a record number of judges on the bench. Extraordinarily qualified judges who follow the law.
We're now less than 2 days away from Prince Harry and Meghan Markle saying their I do's. Britain is abuzz with excitement. So is America. But this royal wedding could change the conversation because the bride is bringing diversity to the royal family. Here's CNN's Jason Carroll.
Brixton. It's a district of South London where you'll find black, Asian, and white cultures all in one neighborhood. It's a place Meghan Markle and Prince Harry have visited before. Markle is celebrated here, like in much of Great Britain, and because she is biracial, her marriage to Prince Harry has also inspired discussion about race relations. Raise your hand. Does everyone know who Meghan Markle
yeah.
is?
Yeah.
These elementary school girls in Brixton are well aware this is a first for the royals.
It's surprising because like, she's one of the first black people to go to join the royal family.
And did any of you ever think that you could grow up and perhaps marry into a royal family? Was that something that any of you even actually thought of?
No.
Why not?
And not many like mixed race black people can join like the royal family.
Do you think it's a good thing?
Yeah.
Why is that?
Because it just shows you that anyone can marry into the royal family.
A recent study found a little more than half of those polled in the UK say race shouldn't matter in the royal marriage. 75% say they would feel comfortable if their children married someone of a different race. But a government study also found a 27% increase in hate crimes in the past 2 years. Stedman Scott has lived in Brixton for some 50 years.
There is a problem in this country, and that is color problem. That is the problem that we have to address.
There have been a number of negative public comments and headlines made about the Markle family and their background. Take this one in the Daily Mail. It reads, Harry's girl is almost straight out of Compton. And then there was the comment made by the sister of the UK's foreign secretary. It reads, Miss Markle's mother is a dreadlocked African-American lady from the wrong side of the tracks.
At one point, Prince Harry stepped in to defend Markle and her family. In a statement, his communications secretary cited the racial undertones of comment pieces and the outright sexism and racism of social media trolls and web article comments. Sundar Kotwala conducted that recent study on race in the UK.
What did you make of some of the horrific things that the British press were writing about Meghan Markle?
Racism's still there. In British society, but it's receded quite a lot, especially across the generations.
And though these girls never expected to see a mixed-race bride in the royal family, they see their marriage as a sign of hope.
I think it'll make a difference slightly because, like, some people are, like, really racist to other people because of their color. And because Meghan Markle is joining the royal family, I think it might make them change their mind.
Jason Carroll, CNN, Brixton, London.
Jason Carroll, thank you. Joining me now is Harvey Young, Dean of Fine Arts at Boston University, who is Meghan Markle's former professor. Thank you so much for doing this, Professor.
Oh, it's my pleasure.
What's it like for you to have your former theater student marrying into the British royal family?
It's a little surreal. It's not quite what you expect. I am used to my students sort of being cast in TV shows and films and being on Broadway, but the royal family audition is certainly new for me.
Yeah, I'm sure you were proud of her because you had seen her on television, her latest series, Suits, and what have you. So I'm sure you were proud of her as an actress, but this is like completely beyond, right?
Oh, it's unexpected, absolutely. Yeah. But I'm certainly proud of her.
What was she like when you knew her?
So I taught Megan back in 2003 when she was a senior, and it was her last quarter. I was at Northwestern University, so it was her last quarter at Northwestern. And she took my Studies in Black Performance class. It was this tiny class with 8 students, and she was wonderful. I mean, she would walk in. She was this sort of force of sort of positive energy. She was ready to dive in conversations about sort of black theater, but also about race and society. I remember her fondly.
Yeah. She says her ethnically ambiguous appearances help shape her identity. What do you think she means by that?
Well, I mean, I remember talking with her, and I believe it was more during office hours than in class, but sort of talking about what it means to be biracial, but also really what it means to be a person who is often misread and assumed to be not mixed, and therefore being in rooms in which you would overhear people air their prejudices and biases, you know, about blackness, or sometimes about whiteness, depending upon what the room was.
Yeah, you know, we just saw the schoolgirls in South London telling Jason Carroll what Meghan Markle means to them. Do you think she will make a difference in how people think about race in England?
Absolutely. I mean, I think that the fact we're having a conversation about race and identity and also ideas of belonging. Because Meghan has been quite outspoken from when she was 21 in my class to, you know, this very day, where she has talked about the need to be open and honest about experiences, to have a dialogue about race, to let many people know that, you know, you can't allow bias to go unchecked. You can't allow people to air their prejudices without actually stopping them, halting the conversation, and then correcting them, you know, as a way of trying to create a more diverse and inclusive society.
You know, as Prince Harry's fiancée, Meghan is already under intense scrutiny. Does being biracial make this spotlight even more glaring, you think?
I think so. I think because there's a way in which it ties in with her youth, right? It ties in with her experiences in college. It ties in with many things she's talked about, in which people do not necessarily know how to read her. And then there's this open airing of prejudice and bias, and in some cases, hate. And I think that that's come to the forefront. And we saw that certainly when the Buckingham Palace issued the statement around the engagement to say, hey, everyone, you know, sort of calm down, leave her alone. You know, this level of racist rhetoric is just intolerable. And the fact that the royal family and Buckingham Palace actually made that statement is in and of itself extraordinary.
Yeah.
It's quite impressive.
Yeah, and it's unprecedented. So listen, the British tabloids have not been kind to Meghan's American family.
No.
Many of the stories written had racial undertones. What do you make of the reaction from the royal family? And when I read that, you said no.
Yeah, I mean, I mean, it goes to show that discrimination exists everywhere, and we know within the UK there have been sort of issues around bias, certainly in terms of discrimination against black immigrants, certainly coming from the Caribbean. You know, there was that whole sort of Keep Britain White campaign from a few decades ago. You know, so I think that some of that has been aggravated by this engagement. But the fact that the royal family hopped in and said, no, we see where this is trending. We're going to stop this. We're going to, you know, like not allow this to occur. That's important. And certainly Meghan is a person who has spent her life sort of dealing with the ignorance and in some cases the intolerance of others, and has been a model of eloquence, but also of sophisticated, intelligent sort of wherewithal to be able to sort of stand up and say, no, this is who I am, this is who my experience is, and I'm going to talk openly and loudly about my experience because other people are like me, but they don't have the platform, they don't have the spotlight that I have, and I'm going to change the conversation for the good.
You'll be watching. I know that you have your university's commencement this weekend, so you won't be able to go. What's your wish for her?
I wish you well. So, if, you know, for the wedding, I will be at Boston University later that day, shaking hands for the 400 graduates who are majoring in theater, visual arts, and music. But for Megan, I just wish her the best. I wish her the happiness that she desires. And I just hope that that spotlight that shines brightly on her allows her to actually change for the better the experiences of others.
Harvey Young, thank you so much. I appreciate your time. Prince Harry and Meghan Markle, I'm going to States of America. Kamau Bell meets with people in the disability community to understand their views on healthcare and how they are portrayed in media. You can see the full episode Sunday at 10 p.m. Eastern.
Sports made on me. I got injured when I was 22 years old, didn't make the right choices, and the choices I made ended up taking a friend's life and costing me the use of my legs. While I was in ICU, I made a promise to my friend that had passed that something good's going to come out of that day. I got involved in adaptive sports. I got involved in helping coach wheelchair basketball. And just being around kids with disabilities gave me something to look for every day.
What do you think people who are disabled get wrong about people who are disabled?
They're surprised that we can live independently and that we can do things. And they're like, oh, good to see you out here. Or you're inspiring me today. And I'm like, well, I gotta get groceries.
Yeah.
I feel like they think we're delicate or fragile, and it's like, no, we're not.
No.
We're steel reinforced, actually.